If I can introduce Nigel Mann, he's been 19 years with WIG, so man and boy, always focusing on noise and air quality. He leads the team of 24 NALO, which is noise, air, light and odour, across the UK. And he's going to look at what's in the news and what's hot topics on air quality and talk about the reality and practicality behind the trends. So with that, Nigel, if I can pass over to you.
Thank you very much. So, yeah, air quality is definitely something that you'll all have heard about, whether it's Dieselgate or, you know, how it's affected people's lives and the health effects, which seem to be constantly in the news, and it's very political. But our job, I suppose, is to try and bring some sense to that, particularly in terms of the planning process, and get some facts behind it. So I'm just going to quickly go through some of these topics, really, in terms of hopefully helping you to understand the sort of things that we have to do, but also the sort of things that from a prospective site might be important as well. So that's just how we're going to go through this. So really, the word air quality is sort of inherent, but what does it actually mean? We're really talking about pollutants in the atmosphere and how they affect our health. And in particular, there are environmental sort of pollutants, if you like. So these sorts of things, nitrogen dioxide being one of the main combustion products, and that affects people's health in terms of asthma and things. But then there are other indoor pollutants. So it's trying to keep an understanding of, you know, that we're surrounded by all sorts of different pollutants, whether it comes from within buildings or it's in a workplace. So some of these volatile organic compounds, for example, would be in the workplace. Radon is naturally occurring. So there's a whole very wide range of different things that we can consider to be air quality. But particularly for today, I'm really talking about those environmental effects, so particularly traffic and combustion related, which are probably the most significant ones, certainly in terms of health, but also in terms of assessment requirements. So if we look at those in particular, we've got PM10, small particulates, basically very fine dust, and nitrogen dioxide and sulfur dioxide, and they can affect us in a variety of ways. You will have heard about some of these, but basically there are all different ways that can affect our health and lead to reduced life expectancy. So that's why it's important, of course. If we look at the health effects, these are some of the key figures that you hear, particularly when you get a lot of these pressure groups trying to make a change, which is an important role. But 40,000 early deaths per year in the UK is still considered to be correct, and that's really what we're trying to avoid. You also got a variety of other effects, or not very quantifiable effects, but still definitely effects on health. And just to try and help us to sort of put this into perspective, I'm not really talking about greenhouse gases or the sort of the pollutants that are affecting the environment. I'm talking about localized pollutants is almost a better way to describe it, that then affect our health. So as you will have heard, politics is very much important because this is not something that is easily dealt with. You know, if it's something like noise, which is something else that I deal with all the time, you can always deal with that fairly locally. You can find a technical solution, but the emissions from vehicles, as we know, has been a big problem for the last 20 or 30 years, and needs that high level solution to it. One of the things that stalled the process perhaps over the last sort of 10, 15 years is that most local authorities were sort of, well, there's nothing we can do about it, so nothing really happened. Then this Client Earth sued the government and basically said, we need to meet these legal limits, otherwise, but basically there could be fines on the local authorities if these limits are not met. So that's then really pushed things for the last sort of 5 years to get some of these strategies actually working. And then on top of that, we had Dieselgate, which basically was not helping us to understand exactly what was going on with the emissions. So everything is governed really by these limits. So these limits are set, what they were set nearly 20 years ago, some of them, and are all based on health effects. So they're all based on the onset of health effects in the most sensitive members of the population. And so the key ones here are these PM10, which is and PM2.5 is particulate matter, very, very small, 2.5 microns, that then gets into the lungs, and nitrogen dioxide. And these are the main vehicle emissions, and you can see there are criteria, different criteria for those that have to be met. Most of them are, we look at them over an annual average because these things are affected by season and weather, and some of them we will also look at, so that's these annual means, and then some of them we look at a daily or even an hourly mean, to depending on how those health how the health is affected. So there's a number of controls that are in place. Most importantly, local authorities have got air quality management areas, and those are areas where the air quality has to be managed. In other words, those are areas where these limits, these objectives, national objectives, are exceeded, and therefore something's got to be done to bring them down to make sure that levels are at a safe level. And so those are the sort of key geographical, and I'll show you where some of those are, these air quality management areas. There are also air quality action plans that then go with those air quality management areas. So this is how we as a local authority or London as a, or even or national policies and strategies can then actually reduce emissions down. And the local authorities have a variety of duties in terms of monitoring and measuring and things. As you would expect, London is the big problem, to be honest. The key number here for nitrogen dioxide annual mean is 40 micrograms per meter cubed. And so when we look at this scale here, everything sort of pinker than yellow, if you like, is where that 40 is exceeded, and even some of these, so that's effectively the whole of central London. And so that is why there is a real big push to try and get electric vehicles, get all these other strategies and things in place to reduce these levels down, and low emission zones and all these other things that we're trying to do to reduce the pollutant levels, because as you can see, some places are significantly above these levels, and there's a lot of work to bring that down. It's a mixture of vehicle emissions, but also as we're reducing vehicle emissions, we're seeing that emissions from boilers and other sort of plant and even sort of domestic emissions are also contributing. So that's again another reason why there's a really big problem here in London, because it's not just the traffic, it's the sheer magnitude of people and industries and offices together. London is obviously leading the way also in terms of reducing emissions. If we look maybe across different parts of the country, these air quality management areas are slightly different approach from different authorities. So you can see here in Manchester that effectively, so the blue is the air quality management area, and effectively it's it follows all the main roads with a blob in the middle, if you like. Whereas other authorities, take Sheffield for example, they've taken we're just going to make the whole authority an air quality management area because we want to deal with it everywhere. So there is a slight, there is still a slight different approach in how to manage the air quality. But basically, whenever you're looking at a site within an air quality management area, that means it has to be either assessed or at least scoped in or out of an assessment to make sure that it's been considered. So the first thing to do with any site is to look at whether there's air quality management area. If we look at the Midlands, for example, similar type of thing, you've got somewhere like Leicester where you've got a spider approach almost, you know, city centre where it's where levels above 40, and then the radial roads coming out of it. But then Birmingham takes a whole authority approach, and that doesn't mean that the whole of Birmingham is above 40 micrograms per metre cubed for nitrogen dioxide, but it's to do with how they're managing it. So there's a slight different approach and in how they're looked at. When we undertake an air quality assessment, this is our Bible, if you like. This is the latest how to do it guide. So this tells us how to assess significance, how to undertake the modelling, and how to undertake some calculations. Because at the end of the day, whenever we're introducing new traffic or new receptors into an area that's already polluted, we will have to assess the effect of that on the surrounding area and on the proposed residents. There's a whole load of different things that we have to look at, but effectively it does relate down to traffic. So there's a very much a connection between what we're doing in terms of an air quality assessment and what our traffic colleagues are doing in terms of predicting what the baseline is, what's going to happen with any new development or any change, even if it's bringing in a car-free development, what is the existing baseline traffic levels that we can then predict what's pollutant levels are going to be. And often this is also in three dimensions. So not only do we have to deal with time in terms of averages, but also if you've got a tall building, as you go up the building, for example, then you get less pollutants. So there's a whole load of different things that that we have to put in. But usually we'll undertake a modelling to find out what the levels are going to be. So if we're looking at residential schemes, for example, we're looking at how much additional traffic there is, and we're looking at that introducing that new sensitivity and what needs to be done to mitigate that. We will look at the existing areas. So the whole of the UK has got some background maps. So the air pollutants are made up of not just the emissions from vehicles, but there's a sort of a general background of pollutants as well, if you like, from a variety of different sources. Some of them even blow as far across as from other parts of Europe. It's not just simply, oh, well, there's a few cars, here we go, times that by a magic number, and out we get a predicted level of pollutant at the end. There's quite a lot that goes into that. And we have to try and pull in sources from as many different places as possible. So local authorities will undertake monitoring, and we will try and verify our modelling work and our predictions to that monitoring. And there's all these other sources for us to try and get as best picture as possible. In terms of some very small schemes that perhaps not really that high risk, there's a sort of a screening assessment tool that we can use as well that doesn't go the full modelling approach, but we can do a sort of more quick and simple approach that often can scope out air quality if it's fairly low risk site. So there's a sort of a two-tier approach. Everything that we do is monitoring, modelling and mitigation. Sometimes we will actually have to go out and do some monitoring ourselves if there's no local authority monitoring nearby. So typically in a local authority might have between 30 and 100 sites where they're going to undertake monitoring by diffusion tube, which is this little plastic tube here that usually sits on a lamppost or somewhere like that. You might spot them if you're really interested. On if you walk down a busy road, you might find one. And basically, it's a passive sampler. The air comes up the tube, and there's a little thing at the top that collects the nitrogen dioxide. We send that off to the lab. These are put out usually across a wide geographical sort of area. But if there isn't a coverage nearby, then it's possible that we would have to do that. Now, the problem with that is actually cost-wise, they're very, very cheap, £5 a go. So there's not a huge cost, but it's the time involved, because ideally you need a year's worth of monitoring to be able to get this annual average, because you can have almost double the amount of pollutant from 1 month to another, just depending on the weather. So in terms of getting an absolute level, it can be really difficult to do that. However, sometimes 3 months is enough to get an idea of how the pollutants are changing across maybe up and down the building, as in this case here, or across a site, so that you can determine, okay, maybe we can put commercial near to the road and residential can be so far back because we know that the pollutant levels are reducing further away from the roads, that sort of thing. So there's an element of deduction that can still be made even from a fairly short-term survey. Other things like this AQ mesh pod here are sort of automatic, so we can look at how things change over time, and that's particularly important for construction dust and short-term effects. You might be looking at hourly exposure, for example, for maybe a school or something like that as well. So there are different ways of measuring and monitoring. The modelling work that we do is an example of one that we did in Selby Bridge from a source actually here. If you're interested, this is a chimney. This was particularly interesting because what happens here is that the wind is coming from this direction, but you've got a valley here. And so the modelling can be really helpful to try and work out exactly what's going on. In this particular one, you've got low levels in the middle of the valley, and then across the valley where the pollutants are sort of blowing across, you get another high point. And if you're not careful and you only concentrate on a very small area, you're going to miss this effect here. And so it helps to show really the extent that we often have to look at. The other thing that we have to look at from the modelling point of view is also the effects not just on people, but also on the ecology and SSSI areas and things like that. So we often do have to go quite broad with our modelling. the general way that mitigation is working, you get direct mitigation in terms of if you're putting new people into an existing poor air quality area, but there are things that we can put in terms of filters to make sure that their air is nice and clean. However, when it comes to, you know, the effect of extra traffic, the way that seems to be going is that there's a calculation that can sort of effectively calculate the amount of damage that air pollution is costing in monetary terms. And this calculation then allows that damage to be mitigated by the development introducing a variety of different things, but basically things like electric vehicle charging points or green travel plans, putting on buses, all those sorts of traffic reduction measures can then be added up the value of that, and then we try and balance out the damage from the air quality against the benefit of some of these schemes. So that's generally how it works. In London, as I said, there's a lot more contribution being seen from boilers and from other sort of heat sources. So there's a separate way that we need to assess the effects of that. And it's looking for a neutral air quality, neutral assessment is what we do in London. And that looks at those emissions. This COVID-19 situation has been really interesting for us. We've actually seen a 20% reduction in emissions as a result of that reduced traffic. So it's going to be really interesting to see if that's going to continue or how all these policies and changes in our lifestyles and things are actually going to be able to reduce these emissions further. So that's really an interesting thing to look at the moment. We've got predictions from the government that we have to use in terms of how the emissions from vehicle fleets are going to reduce over time. And it's going to be interesting to see if that's going to reduce other things like Brexit and these that this PM2.5, this really fine fraction, that these are the things that are sort of hot topics at the moment. A couple of real quick examples, and then we'll go on to some questions. So this one, Aldgate Place in central London, this is interesting really just simply because of the way that it's a really, really tall building. And don't ask us how, but we put those diffusion tubes on the outside of the building as they were building it, which was quite scary, and we had to use ropes and stuff. But anyway, that showed us how this drop off with height is real, and how we were then able to say, well, actually, the bottom few floors, they need to have the special clean air filtration, but the rest of them don't. So, you know, that was quite interesting. And the other one is this one, which is, you can't see it very well, but this is the M25. We're putting houses literally bang next to it. What we're doing here is we're using the houses as a sort of shield to the rest of the site. So all of these houses here have got the filtration, and then we're able to use the design and the layout of the site to then protect and create a good sort of this, particularly this green area in the air in the middle for the rest of the site. And these then don't need to have the mitigation protection that the others had. So that's a couple of interesting examples. So I think I'll leave it there and see if there are any questions.
I'll just kick one off. With the COVID and the changes, and you're saying it takes a year, is there any difficulties that you're encountering, Nigel, with assessments and people trying to push out and delay until we get either more back to normal, or how are councils reviewing any data that you're doing in terms of that? Is it becoming more difficult to get timely decisions?
Yes, it's not too bad. I mean, for example, noise, it is very difficult because at the moment they're just not representative. However, for air quality, we're usually using data from a year behind anyway, because to get a whole year, you need to wait until that whole year's worth of measurements. So we're all still using 2019 data, or sometimes 2018. So in terms of the timescale of getting these things through at the moment, that's not a problem. It's more a case of what will happen at the end of this year, and will this 2020 have to be scrubbed out as an unrepresentative year, or actually maybe it will be exonerated as the best year, but we won't know that until sometime in 2021. So actually it's not a problem.
And the only other second question I was just going to ask was around quite a few cities I know, like Bristol, are bringing forward seemingly very rapidly banning of diesel cars. Directly related, is there a wider drive across various cities that you're seeing against that, or is that just sort of a specific political driver Or is it, yes. is it a sort of legal challenge driver that you were talking about?
It's a bit of both. Some authorities in some cities are pushing further, and that's perhaps because they've got bigger problems. And so Oxford, for example, is driving the way with ultra low emission zones, and as you say, Bristol with the diesel ban as well. So and London, of course. So some of these places are pushing, and of course it is political, because all of these decisions are political, and you know the effect of setting up one of these zones, you know, affects businesses as well. So there's a huge amount of politics involved. But yes, it is all really to do the same thing, which is to reduce those emissions down to safe levels.
Okay, we've got a couple of questions now coming in from Claire. On large residential schemes where major infrastructure is proposed to alleviate traffic, how does this relate to helping an authority reach air quality neutral at an AQMA?
Yes, so many schemes do include some kind of bypass or it is a road scheme that is specifically designed to take some of the vehicles away. So it is quite possible that we can have a positive air quality effect, and that can be shown as well. And often you get some areas that will see a positive benefit, and there will still be some that will see a negative. So it's a balance about often the number of people exposed to the increased pollutants versus the number of people who are going to see a reduced. But there is a way of calculating that balance and then showing how overall a scheme can be beneficial. So yeah, absolutely, beneficial schemes are quite common, actually.
And we've had another question on developments. When will we expect to undertake air quality assessment to influence the design of the scheme?
Yeah, so that one that I showed in Egham next to the M25, air quality was needed to be influenced right from the very, very early stages. And what you saw there was version, I think, 57 or something like that of the layout. So where there is a really busy road and a very high pollutant source, then I would say it needs to be thought about really at the very, very beginnings, that you can get that best design. However, for the majority of sites, it's not that significant. It's only really where you've got that super busy road, or if you're in a really busy, in the middle of an air quality management area. So I would say you do a screening very early on just to check where you are with the levels, or even check whether there's an air quality management area there, which there's a website that shows where they all are. Do that first, but otherwise it can wait normally till once the traffic assessment's been done, and usually fairly towards the end, to just sort of tick that box and make sure that the mitigation is appropriate.
If I'd just like to say thank you very much, Nigel. That was very interesting, and look forward to seeing people again in a couple of weeks on our next seminar. And in the meantime, keep safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you.